Hello guys, welcome back to my YouTube channel. Today in this video, we are going to study one of the important questions which are coming in the interviews, in data science interviews, which is evaluation metrics of a regression problem. So we will be going through each and every evaluation metrics which are there, and we will be studying in detail. So let's start the video. Evaluation metrics for regression problem. So we will be now looking why evaluation is important while performing the regression model and classification problem. Today basically we will be looking on the first only, not on the classification but regression problem. So most beginners and practitioners most of the time do not bother about the model performance. The talk is about building a well-generalized model. So most of the persons who are working, who are practicing data science and who are performing ML models, they are just not bothered about the model performance. Just they talk about is the model which is learned properly on the training data, but they don't look out the how much good their model is performing. And in the machine learning and data science, there cannot be the 100% efficiency of any model. If you are getting like that type of result or performance from your model, then it could be biased, or it could be biased model, because in the real world there is no such model who can give you 100% result. So if you are getting also 100% result, it could be because of the overfitting or underfitting. Overfitting and underfitting is one more concept which is very much important. We will be looking these two words and what is the meaning of it after in the next question, but just we will be looking today is the evaluation metrics. So it is necessary to obtain the accuracy on training data, but it is also important to get a genuine and appropriate result on unseen data. Otherwise, model is of no use. So what we are doing, we are building the model on a training data. And we are testing our model on a test data. So if it is necessary to train the model on a training data and how well it is performing, that we have to check with the unseen data, which our test data, or we can use another data, but that type of data only. So from there we can get to know how well our model is performing. So to build and deploy a generalized model, we require to evaluate the model. If you have you have trained a model and then you want to deploy it somewhere, so you need to know how well it is performing. So for that purpose you need evaluation metrics of that problem. That is why evaluation metrics are so much important in a model for checking the model performance. If one of a metric is perfect, there is no need for multiple metrics. In the regression problem itself, there is 6 evaluation metrics. So there were some of the drawbacks in each and every of the evaluation metrics. So to overcome that, the other evaluation metrics came. So by that, the number increased, and it is now the most popular ones are the 6 evaluation metrics which we will be looking in the further video. To understand the benefit and disadvantages of evaluation metrics, because different evaluation metrics fits on a different sets of data set. In there are different type of evaluation metrics, and on a different data set different evaluation metrics are used. You can't use a single evaluation metrics on each and every data. There are many evaluation metrics, so you have to apply according to the data set evaluation metrics. That what it is written over here. Some of the evaluation metrics perform well on the outliers present in a data set, so that evaluation metrics you have to use. And some of the evaluation metrics perform well when there is no outliers present, so that metrics you have to use. We will be looking that in the future videos. We will be looking in the further video, further in this video. Now I hope you have got the importance by all these points. Now we have got the like why it is so important to check the model performance. So let's start with the first evaluation metric, which is mean absolute error. Mean absolute error, I will be showing you this. I have drawn and kept for you to understand that. This I have drawn and kept for you guys. Here it is written mean absolute error. I will be explaining you here. So I have took a data set called your X is our CGPA, like the student data set where CGPA is given of the students and how much salary they will get if the CGPA is that much. So salary will be in LPA, lakhs per annum. So I have took a data set, dummy data set to explain you guys. And this cross cross which I have marked, that is actual values of CGPA. And your LPA numbers I have kept. Okay, and these are all the data points. This line is a regression line which I have drawn, which is our model, regression model. And this line is the predicted value, and but this is our actual value. So here there is difference. Okay, so this is an error which we are seeing. So that is written, that is called as absolute error. So the word AE come from here only, absolute error. So the formula, let's see the formula how MA is calculated. Sigma is for total addition of all the numbers, all the data point of CGPA. Y is your actual output. Means this cross values will come over here, minus y hat means the predicted output, means this line's values will come over here, divide by n. N means total number of data points. So by this formula, MAE is calculated. So absolute value of residual and error. So how we will be calculating this MAE? We will be taking the mean of all the errors and we will getting the number, one number that is called as an MAE. Okay. So this is the MAE. It is just giving us the error, how much error is there in our actual minus predicted. And absolute means it will not give us the negative value. Your mod is there. Mod, if any negative number is there, when it come out of the mod, it become positive. So suppose I will give one number is there, like actual value was 12, but model predicted as 14. Okay. So after subtracting, it will become 2 and negative part, but your mod is there, right? After removing from the mod, it become 2 only. So this is our error. So like this way, from every data point, it will be correcting the error, adding it, and then we will divide it with the total number. So we will be getting mean absolute error. Mean means average. That is why we are dividing with the total number of data points. So we will be getting MAE. So let's go to that. So MAE is a very simple matrix which calculates the absolute difference between the actual and predicted values. What it is doing, it is giving us the values, which is the difference between the actual and the predicted values. That is the main work of MAE. To better understand, let's take an example. I have showed you these all things. And this formula MAE 1 upon n, and we are dividing because we want the mean of the errors. So let's see the advantages of MAE. By this evaluation matrix, what advantages you will be getting? The MAE you get is in the same unit as in the output variable. Here our output variable was a number is LPA, salary in LPA. Suppose the number comes 0.36. So this is our error, which will be the number in LPA only. So it becomes easy to understand how much error is there. So this much numbers error is there in each and every data points. And it is most robust to outliers. It is robust to outliers. Whenever any outlier is present, suppose the outlier is over here. So it is not degrading the model performance because of this simple, because of this single data point. Okay. So this was the advantages of MAE. Now we will see the disadvantages. In each and every evaluation matrix, you will be seeing disadvantages because of disadvantages only the new evaluation matrix came. So disadvantages of the MAE is the graph of MAE is not differentiable. So we have to apply various optimizers like gradient descent, which can be differentiable. For this statement to understand, I will be showing you. One more bit, guys. For better understanding, I have. Ask to ChatGPT. So I have wrote the graph of MAE is not differentiable. So we have to apply various optimizers like gradient descent, which can be differentiable. So how I can understand this above line? So it has beautifully generated the answer. So what we have seen was the MAE, and it's a formula that only it is written. The main line which is written over here is that this paragraph. From here we will be understanding the mention of the graph of MAE is not differentiable means that if you are able to plot the MAE as a function of model parameters, weights, and biases in the case of neural networks, the resulting graph would not be smooth and continuous everywhere. The reason for this non-differentiability is the absolute value operation in the MAE formula. By MAE, we are getting the absolute error So when we are when we are plotting the MAE as a function, so sometimes the graph is not smooth and continuous everywhere because of the absolute value. So it becomes difficult to differentiate. When training a why does differentiability matters? Let's see, read this. When training a machine learning model, optimization algorithm like gradient descents are commonly used to find optimal value for the model parameters that minimizes the loss function. In this case, MAE gradient descent relies on calculating gradient, which represent the rate of change of loss with respect to each model parameter. If the loss function is not differentiable at some point, the gradients cannot be calculated at those point, and standard gradient-based optimization techniques cannot be directly applied. The absolute value function is not differentiable at the point where its argument is zero. However, gradient descent relies on derivatives to update parameters in the direction that reduces the loss. The main thing is that because of the absolute value, the graph which we are plotting, it is not smooth. Because of that, it becomes difficult to differentiate. That is what it is written. That is the main disadvantage of MAE. Now let's go on to the next evaluation metric, which is MSE. Your MAE and MSE are similar, totally similar, but little bit changes is there. In MAE, there was mod and there was mod in actual minus predicted values, but in MSE, you will be getting mod will be not there and the squares will be there. But that's it, and this much changes are there. And total, it is same like MAE, just square is there and mod is removed from here. And each and every terms and calculation remain the same. Let's read this. MSE is most used and very simple metrics with a little bit changes in the mean absolute error. Mean absolute error state the finding of a squared difference between the actual and predicted values, which I told here. It is squaring the actual minus predicted values. Suppose it is the same graph where on the x-axis it is CGPA of the students and on the y salary is given in LPA, and we have plotted our actual data points and we have built a linear regression line. So when we are evaluating with the MSE, so we are finding the square differences of absolute minus predicted. So these are the squared distances, which are the errors. There we were just calculating the absolute error, but here what we are doing, here we are squaring that error. That much changes is there. That's only the changes which is there. I have drawn this for you guys to understand. From this diagram, you can easily understand. Okay. Let's go on with the So we are finding the absolute difference and we were finding the squared difference. Above we were doing finding the absolute difference, but here a little bit difference. Just we are square finding the squared differences. That's just the change which is there, and it is totally same like above, like MAE. What actually the MSE represent? It represent the squared distances between the actual and predicted values. We perform squared to avoid the cancellation of negative terms, and it is a benefit of SE. So whenever the suppose the error was like the error was of minus 2, because of squaring its negative values become positive. That's what it is written, and that is the biggest benefit of using MSE. And formula is same like that, MAE, just square comes over here. And sorry guys, I made a little mistake. Your negative values will be there, and because of the negative values, the graph become undifferentiable when we are plotting the loss function. So here, that was a disadvantage, but here it is overcoming that disadvantage. Here, because we are squaring the errors, the negative values will be not there, and it will be become the absolute number. Because of that, it becomes the greatest benefit of using MSE. Note that point, guys. Now we will see the advantages of MSE. What all advantages are there? So above, that was we were unable to differentiate, but here we are overcoming that. We are able to differentiate the graph when we are plotting this loss function on a graph. So these are our advantages of MSE first, and disadvantages is disadvantages I will be explaining here. The values which we were getting above was the absolute number, and it was representing a proper error number. Suppose error was of, I gave you the error, like the error was 0.38. So it was related to 0.38 lakhs error was there in each and every data points. So it was based on the context, and we were able to understand the error. In each and every data point, there was 0.38 error. But here, because of the squaring, the number becomes 0.36 square. So we will be getting number which will be a square of this. So it becomes a little bit difficult to understand exactly what is the number. Like suppose after squaring that this num suppose after squaring we get the number like we are getting the number from here only. I'm not telling if you're I am taking some any number like 6.83 is the error. In each and every data point, there is 6.83 is the error. So to understand this error, it become difficult because it is a squared one, no? So if you will ask to means someone has evaluated and evaluated with MSE using this evaluation matrix, and you are asking to that person how much is the error which is giving to you. So he will be telling 6.83. So it will become difficult for us to understand 6.83 because we need to now remove the square root, and then we will get the exact number. So it become little difficult to get the exact number. So that what is the biggest disadvantage of this evaluation matrix. And if you and it is also second disadvantage is it is greatly affected by the outlier. Suppose one of the data point was over here. Here is our data point. So what we were doing, we were finding out the squared differences between actual and the predicted. So we got this much squared, this much squared distance because of this single data point. It degrades our model performance. So that what it is written as it penalizes the model very badly due to outlier. This is the outlier. So because of one outlier, its performance reduces drastically. Because of this single data point, your whole model's performance goes down. So it is not robust to outlier. This is the second disadvantage in the MSE. I hope you guys understood this outlier and why it is degrading our performance. Because see, this much is the error, and we are squaring that, so that number is increasing in a double number. So because of that, the error becomes too big. Because of that number become have that number have become too big, the more error have raised very high because of this single data point. If suppose there are many outliers, then it will affect very badly. And I forgot to tell you guys the main evaluation means the main aim of MAE and MSE is to reduce the error as much as possible. So what we are getting here is the error terms. So we want to reduce it. So whatever number is coming from after removing this MAE and MSE, we have to just reduce it because it is an error term. The more we will reduce our error, the more accurate our model will be. So the main aim of this all evaluation metric is to these two evaluation metric is to reduce the numbers of the error. So that I forgot to tell you, so I told you here just now. So these are the two main disadvantages of MSE. Next we will be seeing the root mean squared error. It is totally same like your MSE, just your this part have came root part, and it is totally same like MSE only. N is there for mean because we are dividing it with our total number of data points, and I is equal to 1 to N means how many data points are there from 1 to total number of data points from all it will be adding, and actual minus predicted. That same is there error differences. So let's read the advantages of RMSE. The output value you get is in the same unit as the required output value, which makes interpretation of loss easy. The error after evaluating with RMSE, we get some number. Suppose that number is 0.36. Because we have applied root this thing, because of this the number which we are getting, that is the exact error. So it become easy to understand this numbers error is there in my model. So it become easy to understand. This is the advantage of RMSE. Second disadvantages of RMSE is it is not robust to outliers. Same like the MSE. It is not that robust to outlier as compared to MAE. Or in MAE, it was robust to outlier, but in MSE and RMSE, it is not robust to outliers. Most of the people use RMSE as an evaluation metrics, and mostly when you are working with a deep learning techniques, most preferred metric is RMSE. RMSE is majorly used in the deep learning models, where when we are building deep learning models, we are using RMSE as a matrix, and most of the time it gives, most of the times many of them are using RMSE only, and it is working properly over there. And majorly in the deep learning techniques, RMSE is majorly used. So this was the third evaluation matrix as with respect to regression problem. Now the fourth one is root mean squared log error. Taking the log, I will just reading here and I will not explaining you. Taking the log of the RMSE matrix slows down the scale of error. Here, what we are doing, we are taking the log of the error. So the if the range of the numbers were in range of the number were to the range was very high. So by taking the log, the range becomes small. The metric is very helpful when developing a model without calling the inputs. In that case, the output will vary on a large scale. To control this situation, RMSE, we take a log of calculated RMSE error and resultant we get as RMSLE. It is same like RMSE only. Here just we are taking the log so that the big range was very high first, the errors range, but now because of log the range have been reduced. And this type of evaluation metrics are majorly used in the machine learning competitions, which is the RMSLE. This is the fourth evaluation matrix as respect to regression problem. Next, we will be seeing the fifth evaluation matrix, which is R2 squared. So our next matrix is, which we are going to see, is R2 square. R2 square is a matrix that tells the performance of a model, not the loss in an absolute sense, that how well did your model perform. So in the previous matrices, we were seeing that the error which we were getting, which it was on the context of Y, but in the this matrix you will not see such case. You will get a absolute number which will be not a which will not be representing the Y. In contrast, MAE and MSE depend on the context, as we have seen, whereas the R2 score is independent of context. MAE and MSE were dependent on the Y. So if the errors, if the Y was our salary in LPA, so the error it was showing us, it was 0.36 errors in 0.36 LPA's error in each and every data point it was there. But in R2 score, you will be it will be giving us the number which will be not dependent on Y. It will be not dependent on Y. It will be independent of the Y variable. So that what it is written over here. So with the help of R square, we have a baseline model to compare a model which none of the other metrics provide. The same we have seen in a classification problem, which we call a threshold, which is fixed to 0.5. So basically, R2 squared calculates how much regression line is better than a mean line. So I will be showing you the diagram which I have made to explain you guys. So your same, I have took the data set, which is X is our CGPA of the students, and Y how much salary they will get in that particular CGPA. In it is in a LPA, like 7.7 lakh per annum package is there. So Y is salary in LPA. So I have represented my data in this graph, CGPA in the x-axis and salary on the y-axis. Okay. And here are all these cross lines are the data points. So this line represent our regression line, regression model line. And here this line represent the mean model, which is just taking salary into consideration and just giving the average of the salary. Whatever the CGPA is, it is just giving us the mean of salary. So our mean model is not taking X into consideration, whereas our regression model is taking X variable into consideration and then plotting a line. So how we are calculating R2 square, that formula is here. R2 square is equal to 1 minus SSR upon SSM. SSR is squared sum error of regression line. Your squared sum error. So with the mean model, mean line, these boxes are the squared sum error of mean line. Okay, these big boxes you can see, these are the errors with respect to mean. But whereas in the regression line, we can see these small boxes are there, which is showing less error as compared to the mean line. So what we are it is going to do, it will be going to divide the errors with the regression line divided by mean line, and whatever number will come after division, we will be subtracting it with 1. So that will give us the number which will be in range of 0 to 1. If the number is towards 1, then you can say your R2 score is good, your regression model is performing well. But when it is near to 0 and in negative, then you can say it is the worst model that you have made, which is unable to. If it is 0, then you can say it is just a mean model you have built and it is not taking X into consideration. But when it is going more than 0.3, 0.4, then you can say it is taking some of the point into consideration. And whereas if the R2 score is in negative, then it is performing very worst. It is not even able to take the mean also, and it has drawn a regression line somewhere else, which is worse than the mean if the number is going in the negative. So that you have if this all things can happen when you are going you are building a model on the non-linear data. If you are building your model on non-linear data, then it will be giving you negative R2 score because that data set is not suitable for this model. You have to go to other model and then try to build, like decision tree regressor is there. But so this will be giving you a number that will be in the range of 0 to 1. If it is towards 1, then it is your good model. If it is nearby 0, then you have to improve it or you have to just tune it. But in with the R2 score, it is also called as coefficient of determination or goodness of fit. Another two names are there. You have to keep in mind which is these two names, coefficient of determination and goodness of fit. And this is the formula which I explained you. And here what it is given, just I will be reading you and explaining you in a short because I have explained you before only. So here I will be going fast. How will you interpret the R2 score? Suppose if the R2 score is 0, then the above regression line by mean line is equal, means so 1 minus 1 is 0. If the R2 score is 0, like this R2 score is 0, when it will be 0, when 1 minus 1 will be there over here, then it will give us 0. That means it is a very worst model that you have built. And the second case would be when your R2 score will be 1. When it will be 1, when this 1 minus your SSR divided by SSM is 0, then it will become R2 score will become 1. So that will be a very a model that is able to catch all the X variables and it is giving 100% result. So that is not possible in the real world data. Okay, so we can conclude that our regression line move towards perfection, R2 score move toward 1. Okay, when our linear regression line is catching most of the data, then the most of the data of X, then our R2 score will move towards 1. And when it is unable to catch more of the data of X, then it will be moving towards 0. Okay. So that is what it is written over here. The normal case is when R2 score is between 0 and 1 line is 0.8, which means your model is capable to explain 80% of your variance of data. If your R2 score is 80%, 0.8, that means 80% of variance, I mean X, 80% of X values it is able to catch, and other 20% it is unable to catch because of some other reasons. But that much data point it can capture, and from 100 data points, 80 data points it is able to predict. So that what it is written over here. Variance means the X values, different X values it is able to capture when it is 0.8, means 0.8% it is able to capture, and rest of the 20 it is unable to. So this was our R2 square. So next is our adjusted R2 squared. Why this came adjusted R2 square? Because when we were adding more features to the regression model, our R2 score was increasing. When it was if it is when the features are relevant, then it is increasing, then we are okay. But the problem comes when the R2 score start to increase. When it is R2 score start to increase when our irrelevant model irrelevant features are added. When the irrelevant features are added, it shouldn't be increasing. So that is a logic behind that. So it should not increase. That is why that was the disadvantage is which we saw in the R2 square. So to overcome that, we brought a the researchers and scientists brought a new evaluation matrix, which is adjusted R square. So I will read this sentence once more so that you can get to know what it is one more time. The disadvantage of R2 score is while adding new feature in new in data, the R2 score start increasing. If a new feature is added to R2 score, it start to increase or it remains constant. But it never decreases because it assumes that while adding more variance of data increases. When the data is relevant, then it should increase. That is our main goal. But when the irrelevant data or variables are added, then it shouldn't be increasing. I will be explaining you this in the example also. But the problem is when an irrelevant feature is added in the data set, then at that time R2 sometimes start increasing, which is incorrect. Yes, when the irrelevant feature is added, so R2 score start increasing. So logically it is not correct. So to overcome that, adjusted R square came. Let's see this formula. Formula is little big, but it is very easy to understand. RA2, this represent adjusted R2. 1 minus bigger bracket, then smaller bracket, n minus 1 divided by n minus k minus 1, smaller bracket close, multiply by smaller bracket 1 minus R2 square, smaller bracket close, then bigger bracket close. So n is here our observations, number of observation which we are having. And your k is represent number of independent variable which we are having, number of x variables. And r2 is our evaluation matrix of r, evaluation matrix, this previous evaluation matrix r square, that is over here. And r2 is adjusted r2, which is the new one which we are going to see. So for explaining r2, adjusted r2, I have written on the whiteboard to explain you guys. So adjusted r2 square, so suppose that same data set is there of the students where CGPA is given, but here I have to three variables, three x variables, where three are I first variable is IQ, which is an relevant features which will help us to predict salary of a student. CGPA, this is also a relevant feature, but whether, what do you think, whether can help us to identify salary of any student? No, that is why it is written over here, irrelevant feature. Whether is irrelevant feature which is there, and why it will be in a salary in LPA. So this is our data set, suppose. So this formula which we saw earlier, n is the number of observation, k is number of independent variable, means x, and r2 score. Here two cases are there when irrelevant features is added. Suppose we are having data set and its observation is 501 and number of k is x variables are 6, and in this irrelevant features are also added. That is what I have written over here just to show you. And r2 score was, which we got 0.8. Okay, so when we will be calculating adjusted r2, 1 minus 501, and in the place of n, 501 will come, then minus 1 divided by n minus k. N was 501 minus k. K was here. K will come over here. 6 minus 1. Okay. And 1 minus r2. So r2 was 0.8. So we will be calculating it. So 501 minus 1. So it will come 500. And this, after subtracting, we are getting 494. Okay. Then here 1 minus 0.8 is 0.2. Okay, so here what it will be, we have to divide. So after division, I have got 0.98 over here, and here in the next step we will multiply. So 0.98 multiplied by 0.2, so it is giving me 0.19. So after that we have to subtract it with 1, so it becomes 0.80. So as you can see, when the irrelevant features were added, our R adjusted R2 didn't increase. That this was our main goal. When irrelevant features are added, R2 score shouldn't increase. So our adjusted R2 score is it is able to recognize the irrelevant features, and it is not increasing its performance. So that what our goal was. So from this we are able to understand this. Suppose when the relevant features are added, in the so only three were the relevant, and by that three features we got this much R2. Okay, so we will be calculating it manually. So I have first only calculated so that it doesn't take more time in the video. So 1 minus this 501 minus 1, so it becomes 500, and this after division, after subtraction, I will get 497. Okay, and multiplication by 1 minus 0.73, so it becomes 0.27. So after division, this number came, and here after multiplication 0.99 multiplied by 0.27. After multiplication I got this 0.26. So I subtracted it with 1. So it got I got 0.63. SAN4. When relevant features were added, our R2 score start to adjusted R2 score start to increase because the relevant features are giving more, means they are able to, they are helping us to determine our why. So this adjusted R2 score is able to take relevant and irrelevant features into consideration, and then only it is increasing our accuracy, our performance. So adjusted R2 score becomes a very useful metrics when there are irrelevant features also in our data set. So when there are only relevant features, then you should go with R2 score. When there are irrelevant features in your data set, then you should take adjusted R2 score as a evaluation metrics in a regression problem, in a regression problem. So these all were the evaluation metrics which we saw. So hope you guys understood all the evaluation metrics, and I have explained you with the mathematics also. So what is going behind the scenes. So hope you guys liked the video. If you have liked this video, so please like, share, and subscribe my channel, and I will meet you in the next question, which I will be explaining you in detail. So see you in the next video.